Our presentation tonight will last approximately 1 hour and will be presented by Dr. Laurence Levine of UroPartners, based out of Chicago, Illinois. Dr. Levine attended medical school at the University of Colorado Medical School in Denver, Colorado, and then went on to train at Harvard's Program of Urology in Boston, Massachusetts. Dr. Levine is a world-renowned for the treatment of both erectile dysfunction and Peyronie's disease. In addition to general urology, his primary focus for the past 25 years has been in the fields of andrology and reconstructive urology, including disorders of male sexual function, male infertility, urinary incontinence, congenital deformities, and deformities of the penis caused by Peyronie's disease. He has been an active teacher for the past 28 years and holds many special honors in the field of urology. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight. And without further ado, here is Dr. Levine to get us started.
Well, hello, folks, and I apologize for the techno stuff. I'm certainly not good at this kind of business, and I'm glad to have Annie here and the Boston Scientific team to kind of help solve some of the problems. I'm delighted that you, those of you who are still here, are waiting to hear what I have to say. So I'm going to kind of move on and so that we can get with our program. What we're going to talk about tonight is erectile dysfunction. It's a common problem for sure, and I'm going to talk about what it is, who gets it, and what causes it, as well as the treatment options that are currently available. And I'm going to kind of go from soup to nuts in terms of the all the different options that are available. I am delighted that Boston Scientific was able to help sponsor this, but I should tell you that I'm not being compensated for this presentation. I'm doing this because I really like educating men about ED, which is something I've been involved with in terms of my career and my research for the last 25 plus years. And so I hope this will be a useful program for you. And if there are questions at the end, we'll certainly hang around to be able to address them. So ED, what is it? Well, the definition of erectile dysfunction is that it's described as a persistent inability to achieve or maintain an erection which is firm enough to have sexual intercourse. And what that means is really up to you in terms of being able to have satisfactory sexual relations. And if you're not, then this would be defined as erectile dysfunction. Is prevalent problem. A study done back in the early 1990s looked at a group of men in the privacy of their home. All of those men were over the age of 40, and they found a remarkable thing at that time, that 52% of these men had some degree of erectile dysfunction, and that the older they were more likely to have more erectile dysfunction in that group and more severe erectile dysfunction as well. It's also been shown that men even under the age of 40, probably about 20% of those men, will have some degree of erectile dysfunction. Certainly the younger men who don't have any vascular risk factors, things of that sort, may be more apt due to low testosterone, or maybe even psychogenic things that can interfere with the process of developing an erection that we'll talk about in a moment. But certainly the men, the great majority of men that I see, have a structural problem, most commonly a so-called neurovascular one. So it is a common problem. Let's talk a little bit about what the erection process is. It's really kind of a straightforward thing. We call it a neurovascular event. Neuro being affecting the brain and making it become aroused. And when it's aroused sexually, there are nerves that will be release information down to the penis and release chemicals that will cause these tiny blood vessels in the penis, the biggest of which are 1 millimeter in diameter, typically one on each side. And those blood vessels will, as a result of the message they get from those chemicals, dilate. In essence, we're turning a straw into a hose, and now blood comes running into the penis and fills that space with blood and making it ultimately erect. What happens also during that time is that the blood that normally drains out back into the body, the veins are compressed so that the blood can't leave the body, and this will maintain the erection until the time of ejaculation. Now, historically, we thought of the causes of erectile dysfunction to be, well, it's probably a psychological thing, that if you were to, you know, take a vacation, relax, take it easy, things will get better. What we now know, though, is that the great majority of cases, certainly in men over the age of 40, that there is likely a neuro or more commonly a vascular cause. And what I call the erection busters are the things which are most likely to cause ED, and those would be high blood pressure, elevated cholesterol, smoking, and diabetes. And we'll talk a little bit more about those in a moment. We can also see that prostate cancer treatment, men, about 1 in 6 men will develop prostate cancer, and treatments for the prostate cancer, both radiation and surgery, can have an effect upon erectile function. And in some men, they will present with erectile dysfunction, not even knowing that they have diabetes or heart disease or elevated cholesterol, high blood pressure. There was an interesting study done years ago in London that looked at men who presented with erectile dysfunction and found that about 20% of these men had undiagnosed diabetes, high blood pressure, and elevated cholesterol. So ED can be an indicator of vascular disease elsewhere in the body. So let's talk about some of these things, how the relationship occurs between erectile dysfunction and diabetes to start. So in this slide, you can see that diabetes is unfortunately quite common. About 15 and a half million men in the U.S. have diabetes. And 1 in 2 of those men have sexual dysfunction as a result of diabetes because of vascular and sometimes nerve-related injury. In men with diabetes, oftentimes their erectile dysfunction is more severe than it would be in men without diabetes, and they tend to have a poorer quality of life. And there's evidence to show that the longer you have diabetes, the more likely you're going to get ED, and more likely it will get worse with time, and the more or the less well you control or manage your diabetes, again, there's a greater likelihood that you'll have more severe ED that will respond less well to the treatments that we're going to be talking about in a few minutes. So as it says here also that ED tends to occur 10 to 15 years earlier in men with diabetes than men without, and that men with diabetes tend to respond less well to some of the simpler therapies like oral tablets, like Viagra, Cialis type medications. Diabetes can damage the nerves and tissues associated with achieving and maintaining an erection. As noted, up to 70% of men with diabetes have nerve damage, which we call neuropathy. That's an injury to the nerves within the body, and those can be tiny little nerves or sometimes more major nerves. And the nerves in the penis are quite susceptible to injury due to diabetes. The lining of blood vessels, which we call the endothelial layer. This is the inner lining, which is very responsive to blood flow and can result in blood vessel relaxation and dilation. This lining can be damaged also by diabetes. And this is very important because the oral medications that we always start with for treatment of erectile dysfunction require sexual stimulation from the nerves in the brain, as we talked about, and the nerves that release that information to cause blood vessels to relax. And it requires blood flow, the endothelium. And if these nerves and endothelium are damaged from diabetes, the pills and maybe other treatments will not be as effective. So how can we, diabetes affect men with erectile dysfunction? Well, it can be age-related. The longer you have it, as I said before, potentially the greater the likelihood you're going to have progressive erectile dysfunction. And that usually starts within 7 to 10 years after diagnosis. If you're not maintaining good control, that's going to accelerate that process, certainly. Try to move something here. We'll go. And if you have microvascular complications, this can certainly do it as well. How about erectile dysfunction and heart disease? What's their association? Well, as we've suggested here, ED may be a warning sign of other issues, such as undiagnosed diabetes, high blood pressure, and cholesterol. And we know that those disorders can also be associated with coronary disease, blood flow within the heart. And it's been shown that ED can be an indicator of silent, that means not symptomatic, coronary artery disease. So in other words, you're not having the chest pain and so forth that is typically shown in men with coronary disease, but you could have progressive injury to those tiny blood vessels and then potentially end up with a cardiovascular event like a heart attack. A very interesting study was done some years ago by some friends of mine in Italy. There were two brothers. One brother was a urologist, and the other was a cardiologist. And the cardiologist brother said he was seeing all these men with cardiac disease who also had erectile dysfunction. They elected to do a study, and they found that in 70% of the men who had erectile dysfunction, they also had evidence of coronary disease, and that this coronary and that the erectile dysfunction preceded their development of coronary disease by several years on average. So as it's shown in the cartoons here, symptoms of heart disease oftentimes develop within a couple years of development of ED. And again, this is not all men with ED. This is men who might be at greater risk, particularly men with diabetes, high blood pressure, cholesterol problems, and they're more likely to have a heart attack or a stroke in more time if that is not addressed early. So this ED oftentimes presents before symptoms of heart disease, and the question is, why would that be? Well, if you look at the picture here, you can see on the left a penile artery, representation of a penile artery, and that would be 1 to 2 millimeters in diameter. Those are the big guys within the penis. And as we go up across to the right, we can see the coronary arteries, which are 3 to 4 millimeters, still quite tiny, but you can see a penile artery is a half to a third the size of one of those arteries. And therefore, a 50% occlusion of a penile artery, which will cause significant reduction of blood flow, will not necessarily be seen in the heart or in the blood flow to the brain or the legs until it gets worse. But what it's telling us is that if there's blood flow problems in the penis, this may be the earliest indicator of vascular disease elsewhere. I like to refer to the penis as the divining rod of vascular health. If you've got vascular disease in the penis, you probably have it in the rest of your body. It's just thankfully not revealing itself. And therefore, in men who do have ED, it may be something that we want to investigate further in terms of their vascular health. So what are the things that we can do to reduce the risk of progressive vascular disease in terms of your heart? Well, healthy lifestyle choices are important. So diet. If you maintain a diet which is poor, high in fat, this can certainly cause progressive vascular disease. And so change that. Exercise and physical activity. You might not lose weight from exercise or physical activity unless you're doing it in a very vigorous way for on a daily basis, but it can increase our so-called metabolic rate, our resting metabolic rate, which means you're burning more calories just sitting there, you know, watching TV. Therefore, regular exercise is good because it will actually increase blood flow throughout the body. It might help you lose some weight, but it's good for your general vascular health. Losing weight is always a good idea if you're overweight. And if you're a smoker, absolutely 100% quit smoking. Smoking, in my experience, has proven to be the number one single most common cause of erectile dysfunction. So if you take away just, you know, what is the single thing that causes ED, smoking can certainly do it. And the likelihood of reversing the injury caused by smoking once you get into middle age is actually very low. By stopping, though, you can certainly reduce the accelerated changes that happen in the blood vessels, and that therefore stopping smoking at any time is a good thing to stop progression of your vascular disease. What about prostate cancer treatment? Well, The nerves that provide stimulation for an erection lie, as you can see in the picture here on the right, they're in yellow. Those are the nerves. They lie right adjacent to the prostate. And you know, doctors now with better techniques can peel these nerves off the prostate and sometimes spare the erectile nerves so that men will have erections after surgical treatment, but they still can be compromised even in the best of hands. And with radiation therapy, there are blood vessels which also run adjacent to the prostate and supply the penis. These can be compromised as well with radiation therapy. So it can be a permanent problem or it can be a temporary one. And a lot of it depends upon the degree of injury and what type of erection issues the man had before the treatment of their erectile dysfunction, before the treatment of their prostate cancer, I meant to say. Some of you may be familiar with Peyronie's disease. This is a scarring disorder of the penis that causes deformity. It's one of my areas of great specialty. We see an awful lot of men with this problem from around the world. And what happens is that there is an exuberant scar that forms on the surface of the penis that restricts the expansion of the penis in that area. And that will cause, as the penis becomes erect, curvature or indentation, or even some, one of the worst things is shortening of the penis, because I haven't met a man yet who wants to have their penis made shorter. So the consequences of Peyronie's is that this deformity can interfere with the ability to have intercourse. We have, I saw men today who had curvature in excess of 90 degrees, if you can imagine that. And we see that all the time. This can also interfere with the ability to achieve or maintain erection because it can interfere with the trapping mechanism. And of course, any man who has problems like this in the penis, this can cause tremendous distress and anxiety, which can also interfere with one's ability to get aroused. And this, of course, will put a stress on your relationship with your partner. The signs and symptoms of Peyronie's disease can occur overnight, but it can also develop more gradually. That tends to be the more common presentation. These scar tissues historically have been called plaques. And some people think, well, plaque means it's made of cholesterol. No, it's just abnormal scar. And the characteristic of this disease is once the scar is formed, it does not go away. The normal healing process is interfered with in the Peyronie's patient. And what you can feel if you're examining the penis, you can feel some lumps or bumps. And these lumps are the scar tissue, which result in the deformity. And the deformity, again, can be a curvature. It can be up, down, from one side to the other. There can be severe indentation. We call it an hourglass deformity in some men. And again, that can cause some erectile dysfunction problems as well. Shortening can occur at up to 70%. Some men will have pain, particularly in the early phases of Peyronie's disease, but that tends to resolve with time. And needless to say, this can be both physically and psychologically devastating to the affected man. The treatment options for Peyronie's are limited. There's really no known non-surgical treatment which is uniformly, reliably effective for treatment of Peyronie's. A drug which was approved back in the 2013 called Xiaflex is the only FDA-approved treatment for Peyronie's disease. I've had limited success with this. Surgery does ultimately prove to be the gold standard, and there are several different surgical approaches that can be taken. And that's kind of altogether a lecture in itself to discuss, but there's kind of what we call plication, taking tucks on one side to draw it over, or even doing excising some of the scar and putting some grafts in. And for men who have ED and Peyronie's, placing a penile implant is probably the best way to go. So the physicians who would treat men with erectile dysfunction? Well, you certainly can talk to your primary care physician because they would likely be able to recognize the problem and make sure that there's no contraindication to taking a medication such as Viagra, Cialis, or Levitra. A urologist is more trained in disorders of the male genital tract, and therefore they might be able to have a greater insight into the treatment options. But certainly a ED specialist who can address all the treatment options that we're going to discuss is probably the best person to talk to, I think, because they can really give you all the treatment options and maybe offer them to you in a sequestered kind of way that might make sense. So here are just a kind of a menu of the options which are currently available. There are oral pills, injections, penile implants, vacuum devices, and so-called urethral suppositories. And we'll talk about all those in turn. Let's start talking about the PDE5 inhibitors. This is the Viagra Cialis type of group of medications. How do they work? Well, they increase blood flow to the penis as a result of that sexual stimulation that occurs from arousal. We get vasodilation, and that chemical that's released that causes the blood vessels to dilate can break down. What Cialis and Viagra do is they prevent the breakdown of that good chemical that occurs when we're aroused, and therefore more of that chemical stimulates better blood vessel relaxation. It's recommended that we take this an hour before anticipated sexual activity. Viagra doesn't last as long as Cialis. Viagra and Levitra last about 4 to 6 hours, whereas Cialis can last as long as 36 hours. Now, when I say last, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're walking around with an unwanted erection. It would only occur when you're aroused, and then you get the erectile response that you might want at that time. It should only be taken once a day, and there are some of these medications can be affected by food. As far as efficacy, you know, these drugs have been around since the mid-late 90s. We know a lot about them now. Most of them are available as a generic drug, so they're much less expensive than they used to be. And probably 60 to 80% of patients will get a good response to the pills. A lot of it, again, depends upon how advanced their vascular disease is. For somebody who I call a vasculopath, hypertension, diabetes, smokes a couple packs of cigarettes a day, those men are probably not going to do so well with pills. But the less severe vascular disease, yep, we might do just fine with the pills. Those men who have had prostate surgery, oftentimes the nerves may be so severely damaged that the signal of arousal is not reaching the penis, and therefore the pills aren't going to work. And again, men with diabetes, as we've talked about tonight, 1.5 to 2 times more likely to need more advanced therapy. The common side effects of oral medications are due to blood vessel dilation. Tends to be most common in the head and neck. So we see headache, facial flushing, stuffy nose, upset tummy can be the most common ones. There is no evidence that these drugs cause a problem to your heart directly. In fact, they cause blood vessel relaxation in the heart, and that's a good thing. But if you do have cardiac disease, it is important that you talk to your physician to make sure that it's advisable for you to consider moving ahead with trying to have sexual activity. Some men may have such severe heart disease that they cannot tolerate the exercise of sex, which is really not that vigorous. Some of you may remember that Jack Nicholson movie where he was trying to walk up a flight of stairs after having a heart attack. That was going to be allowing him to be able to have sexual activity. It was pretty accurate. A man who can walk up a flight of stairs without significant chest pain or shortness of breath probably can be able to resume sexual activity. There are medications called alpha blockers. Sometimes these medicines are used for the prostate, like Flomax or alfluzosin. But there's also alpha blockers can be used for blood pressure control. They need to be at a stable dose for a while before you would introduce a Viagra or Cialis. And for any men who are on nitrates, such as nitroglycerin or Imdur, this is to me an absolute contraindication. You cannot take Cialis, Viagra, Levitra, Stendra, any of those drugs, while at the same time taking a nitrate, because they can cause irreversible, catastrophic reduction of blood pressure. Vacuum erection device, VED, is another option. This is one of the very earliest options that became available since the early 1900s. Basically, it's a simple concept. You're taking a hollow plastic tube, placing it over the penis, and then with either a hand or battery-powered device, you create a vacuum which will pull the blood into the penis. And once the erection is achieved, a tension band, a constriction band, is then placed around the base of the penis to maintain the erection. And yes, it's been shown that up to 80% of patients can get a satisfactory erection. But despite having a erect penis, many men don't like this approach for several reasons. And those include these side effects and reasons for discontinuation. Those reasons include blocked ejaculation. You can get black and blue bruising caused by the vacuum. There can be discomfort caused by this constriction band at the base. It can make the penis kind of cold or blue and numb because of the constriction band again. And the most common reason, therefore, are that the mechanics of the process is difficult. We can have that bruising. It certainly can interfere with the spontaneity of sexual activity because you have to go and put this device on, and that can sort of change the whole mood, of course. And oftentimes the quality of erection just is not quite satisfactory for the patient. So I offer this approach to many of my patients. I would say probably no more than 1% to 2% will ultimately use a vacuum device as their treatment of choice. There are urethral suppositories. It's called MUSE, Medicated Urethral System for Erection. It's basically a tiny, almost like a grain of rice suppository, which you put into the end of the penis, into the urethra, after urination. The wetness of the urine canal helps it dissolve. And typically, if it's going to work, you'll get an erection within 5 to 10 minutes. It's rather expensive now because it's not being used very much. And I've been told it could be up to $70 per pellet, which is quite high. But the other concern with it is it is not as effective as we would like. In fact, no more than 65% seem to get good results. And many of the patients who use this, who get a good result, don't continue to use it because they find it cumbersome to use. But probably the most common side effect is pain. The drug itself can activate pain receptors within the penis. So you feel like you have a toothache in your penis or the urethra or the testicles that can last for several hours in some men. So I find this probably the even less effective or less used in my population of patients than vacuum device is this urethral suppository, but it is an option. Injection therapy is probably the thing that is used most commonly by my patients when they fail oral therapy. And the concept here is that you want to inject a medication that causes those blood vessels to dilate as a result of exposure to these chemicals. The drugs that we currently use in the office are called Trimix. It's a mixture of three different drugs and three different pathways that then cause the blood vessels to relax. This approach has been around since the mid-1980s, so there's nothing new about it. I have thousands of patients who have used it. Interestingly, probably no more than 40 or 50% after a year of using injection therapy continue with it. As seen in the slide here, in the study of 254 men, in time, only 20% continue to use this therapy. And the reason, again, is that it's somewhat clumsy. It sort of takes a little bit of the bloom off the rose in terms of spontaneity. I had a gentleman express it to me very well recently. He had diabetes and hypertension. He wasn't responding to oral medication, so we put him on injections. He had a great result. He had no pain. He had good erections. But he would say that, you know, geez, it was a weekend evening, and he thought, well, maybe I'd like to have relations with my wife. And then he thought, I got to go. I got to get the medication. I got to go give myself an injection. You know what? I think I'll just watch TV instead. So that kind of thing can happen with this. On the other hand, I do have men who have been using it for 20 years and love it. So, you know, a lot of that approach would be determined together. We would, if you were interested in this approach, we could give a trial dose and see whether it makes sense. And the good news about it is if you were to use it and you didn't like it, we can always move on to the next step. We don't burn any bridges with any of these treatments so far. The most common side effects with This approach, injection therapy, is pain. Sometimes the drug itself, it's not the needle, it's the drug itself can cause pain. You can get some scarring if it's not done properly. There is the risk of having an erection, which does last 4 hours or longer. This is usually a disaster because it means having to go to the emergency room. In our experience, in my practice, it happens in less than 1% of patients, and you can get a little black and blue. Why do patients discontinue? They might dislike injections, they might have the pain, or they just don't like the whole process of giving themselves an injection. The final approach, which I think in many men may be the best approach, and we typically take a route of going up this stepwise approach, you know, starting with pills and then maybe consider shots or vacuum. We don't have to do them all, but we kind of take it in that stepwise approach. And oftentimes men will end up not responding to those approaches or not liking those approaches. And we can consider placement of a penile implant. So what does that mean? Well, basically we're replacing a pair of cylinders into the penis through I'm not sure if you can see me, but about a 1.5-inch incision made in the scrotal wall. And through this, we can place the cylinders, a pump inside the scrotum, and a reservoir behind the stomach muscles, usually in about 45 minutes. It's an outpatient procedure. You come in, you go home the same day, and all this can go in the body and is completely concealed. So it is an internal self-contained hydraulic system. Nobody can see it. You can walk naked on the beach and no one's going to say, hey man, what's that? Nothing is visible. By squeezing and releasing the pump, and I'll show you a video in a moment how that works, you are transferring fluid from the internal reservoir into the cylinders, which creates the erection. And with a deflate button, which is built into the pump, you can then release the pressure, and the fluid will then go back to being a more natural, flaccid, soft-looking, normal penis. Efficacy has been great. These have been around since the 1970s. All the companies here, including Boston Scientific, have done a great job to engineer out as much as possible the mechanical issues that might result in a failure of these devices. And so we see 98% of patients reporting excellent, satisfactory to excellent results with their device. In one study, at 7 years after placement, 94% are still in use and free of requiring any type of revision. The most common side effects or complications here would include pain. That tends to be just temporary after the operation. I tell people if you wear a watch, you don't think about your watch and your wrist, it's there. It's part of you. This device would be the same thing. You wouldn't even know it. Typically within 3 to 4 weeks after surgery, you're barely aware that it's even there anymore because the body's now used to the presence of the device. Mechanical malfunction can occur. This can be due to cracking of the tubing, allowing the fluid to run out. And the likelihood of a mechanical malfunction, what I quote to patients is in 10 years, maybe 10 to 15% will have a mechanical failure, which means that 85 to 90% of patients in 10 years still have a functional device. I have many men who have had their device in 20 years or more and are quite happy with it. Infection is another concern, and we'll talk about that in a moment a bit more, but by and large, the risk of infection is in the 1 to 2% range. Now, Boston Scientific has three different types of penile implants. One is called the Spectra, which is a malleable rod. This does not inflate. It's in a sense always firm, but you can position it down when it's not to be used for sexual activity and bring it up, you know, of course, to urinate or to have sexual activity. Probably, again, 2 to 3% of my patients who have implants will get a malleable rod. The great majority want the inflatable device because it can provide rigidity on demand. And when you don't want to be rigid, you have a more normal, flaccid, soft penis. And that comes in two types. One is called the ambercore device, which has, I'm not sure if you can see on the picture here, we have two cylinders that would be considered one component. And then the smaller pump, which is placed adjacent to the testicles. By the way, you're not squeezing the testicles, that would hurt. the pump is easily identified separate from the testicles under the skin of the scrotal wall. And then there's a three-piece device, which has the separate reservoir behind the stomach muscles. This provides more optimum flaccidity. So in the flaccid, non-erect state, it looks quite normal. And then when you inflate, you can get optimum rigidity or get rigidity to the level that you want. And there are several different models of that AMS 700. The AMS 700 implant shown here has, again, the three components, the two cylinders, the pump, and the reservoir. They are coated, these components are coated with an antibiotic impregnated surface treatment, which has been clinically proven and FDA approved to reduce the rate of infection, rate of revision that would be needed due to an infection. So see if I can show you here. This is a cartoon showing a device being inflated and deflated. And to follow this, I actually have a video of a man with a device implanted. So you can see here in the flaccid condition, not visible. He's grabbing the pump through the skin and the fluid is being pushed or pulled from the reservoir into the cylinders, making it erect. The man would then be able to engage in sexual activity. And then by simply pressing the button on the pump, this will allow the fluid to go back into the reservoir, again, creating that internal self-contained hydraulic system. Here is the video I was talking about by a colleague of mine in California, Dr. Cartman, in a man who had a placement of a prosthesis at a previous time. So you can barely see, I mean, there's really no visible scarring. He's grasping the pump and by squeezing, fluid is being transferred from the internal reservoir up into the cylinders. Depending upon the size of the cylinders, it may take somewhere between 5 to 15 pumps. This may take, therefore, maybe 15, 20 seconds to place the device. And you can see a nice erect state. This does not interfere with sensation, orgasm, ejaculation, or urination. All it's doing is restoring one's ability to have a rigid penis that was not occurring before. So the arousal process, the sexual arousal that you get and you feel, that will not change. It just means now you can be able to transfer the fluid into the cylinders that are not filling well with blood. You can now have it fill with saline water, and this will create the rigidity that you just saw. So many studies have been done looking at patient and partner satisfaction. In one study, 97% of patients recommended that the device should be would recommend to their friends that this would be something you should do. Probably the most common thing I hear from men who ultimately have placement of a prosthesis, and oftentimes they hem and haw about it for months to longer, but after they've had the device, probably the most common thing I hear from patients is, hey doc, I wish I'd done this years ago, because it just takes away the concern about being able to obtain an erection while at the same time not changing any of the good parts, the sexual sensation, the orgasm, the ejaculation, and it doesn't interfere with urination. 98% of patients reported their erections to be satisfactory to excellent. And in this partner study that is reported here, 96% of the partners felt as though the sexual activity they had with their partner who had an implant was satisfactory to excellent. I did my own studies years ago, which we published, and we found that across the board, when we asked the female partners of men who had had the device, what did they think about how the device looked when it was flaccid? What did they think about the penis? How did it look when it was hard? And most importantly, how did it feel to them when they were having intercourse? And across the board, the results were very natural. It really seemed to be natural to them. So So the benefits of these devices is that it is designed as a permanent solution. Once you put this in, it's going to solve the problem. Now, it's not the kind of thing, though, that you can say, well, I think I changed my mind. Let's take it out and go back to where it was. Once you put it in, that's the bridge that we don't go back over again. You'll be forever reliant upon the device. It does allow you to have sex on demand. So the gentleman who I mentioned before who said, I don't want to go do the injections. I'll just watch some TV. You're in the mood and your partner's in the mood. You get the green light. Go ahead. You're on your own. Sort of like when you were in your 30s again. It is not restricted to any age group. Believe it or not, I've actually put a device into a 14-year-old, but this was due to a very unusual problem. He had uncontrolled erections, and so we had to do this operation to keep him out of the emergency room, which was a disaster. But I've put them in mostly to men in their 40s to 70s, but I've even put it into men into their late 80s. The erection can last as long as you desire. You want to make love all night long, that's your business. So long as you keep it inflated, it will stay up and then it will come down on demand. It's inside the body, so no one will know you have it if you're in a situation where your penis is exposed. It has high patient and partner satisfaction, as we've discussed. It does not interfere with urination, ejaculation, sensation, or orgasm. These devices, as I said, have been around since the 1970s, so there's a lot of experience with them. In fact, the Boston Scientific devices have been placed in over 500,000 men many of them, you know, still functional and a lot of happy campers. There are risks with any surgery. So you want to discuss those risks and benefits in detail with your physician. The risks that may include, as I said before, it might make natural and spontaneous erections impossible. So it's not like something you can put in and just rely upon your own blood flow. You'll need to rely upon the device to get the erection you want. Mechanical failure, as I suggested, 10 to 15% chance of that happening in 10 years. Pain is variable. I've had some people have had very little pain after the surgery. And I've had others who might last several weeks. We give you all the pain medicine you need to make it comfortable. Men with diabetes, spinal cord injuries, and various sores can have an increased risk of infection. Again, I have done over 3,000 devices now in my career on men with diabetes, high blood pressure, transplant, other immunosuppression type of disorders. And my personal infection rate going back to 1987 is 1.25%. So although that's a risk, it's a low risk. And we have a particular protocol that we've been using for years to keep that risk very low. So in summary, before we have some time for questions and answers, erectile dysfunction is a common problem, as I suggested, probably better than 50% of men over the age of 40, and is frequently associated with other conditions, diabetes, high blood pressure, elevated cholesterol, smoking, prostate cancer, coronary heart disease, and Peyronie's disease, to mention a few. There are a variety of treatment options that we've gone through here, including pills and shots and vacuum devices, but penile implants can offer a permanent solution to the man who is not happy with those other approaches and wants the kind of reliability that they can get with a penile implant. It's certainly reasonable to talk to your partner about this. And you can also talk to your own erectile dysfunction specialist if you don't have one. I'm available to you, of course. You can go online to this site called edcured.org, get more information. And you can go to my website, which you can see under my picture there, drlevinemenshealth.com. There's a variety of topics discussed on my website, including ED, with some videos and some internal discussion that might answer some of the questions you may have that I haven't addressed for you this evening.